10 bands. Hey guys, welcome to the show. I'm Andrew.
And I'm Travis.
Well, we did our predictions and previews for the AFC and NFC Norths. Today we're going to start off with the NFC East, starting with the Dallas Cowboys, who, you know, they kind of came out of nowhere last year going 13-3. Dak Prescott led them on a great season where they ended up losing in the divisional playoffs to the Green Bay Packers. But, you know, with that impressive season, there were a few things they need to get better at for this offseason. So what were some of their needs this offseason?
Basically, all defense.
Pretty much,
got Dak and Zeke and Dez on offense, but breaking it down by position, one of their weakest things on defense was their cornerbacks last year. Obviously, they were kind of getting thrown on a lot last year, so if they could kind of shore up their secondary, that would be huge for them going farther in the playoffs. They also really need a defensive end.
Pass rushers.
They haven't had a great pass rusher since DeMarcus Ware. Yep. They've kind of been searching for their replacement. They've tried guys like DeMarcus Lawrence, and now he got suspended again. So
what a surprise. Cowboys getting suspended. Who would have thought?
And then also the last position of need is linebacker. Mm-hmm. Obviously, Sean Lee had a great year last year. But besides them, he's getting a little bit older, and you don't really have much anybody else behind him.
They're expecting Jalen Smith to kind of...
Yeah, they drafted Jalen Smith. He wasn't able to play last year, so they're kind of hoping this year they can get healthy, they can get him on the field and see what they have out of him. But besides the offseason needs, we'll go into the free agents. Free agency is a time where teams can really go all in, try to make a Super Bowl run. And
Cowboys didn't really have enough cap space to do that, though. They're really tied down with a lot of cap issues. So they had a lot of departures. Let's start with the big one, Tony Romo.
Yeah, no more Tony Romo in Dallas. That just seems wrong.
He's been their franchise quarterback for so long. I kind of feel like he's always been underappreciated.
Yeah.
You know, it's always fun to make fun of his, Tony Romo interception moment or something like that.
Tony Romo always gets injured.
He's been one of the top 10 quarterbacks in this league for a long time.
Yeah.
And, if they had a better team around him, they could have done better. I'm not saying he wasn't ever an elite quarterback. He was never an elite guy, but he played very well for them for a long time. And he got injured. He's in a good position now where he's got a deal as a broadcaster in the booth. So that'll work out for him.
It was really respectable of what he did. He handed over the reins to Dak Prescott last year. Yeah, obviously it was really hard for him to do, but Dak just took the league by storm.
Yep.
And he realized, hey, this is Dak's time. He's the future of the Cowboys.
Yep.
So it was very respectful of him. I mean, he's a great guy.
Mm-hmm.
But, it makes sense for him to go. Obviously he wasn't going to be able to play.
Yep.
So that makes sense. But another really big free agent loss is they ended up losing offensive guard Ronald Larry.
He was starting left guard.
That offensive line has been the best in football, and he's going to be going to Denver, but, that's a little bit of a hole they have to fill.
Yeah, and they also lost Doug Free, their starting right tackle.
So he ended up retiring. Those are
two pieces to the offensive line that's been the best offensive line over the past 3 or 4 years, really.
Yeah.
That's going to hurt them a little bit. That's a huge loss for them. They still have their main guys there. They have Lael Collins there as well, who can fill in at one of those spots.
I think they're going to try to put Lael Collins at right tackle for Doug Free.
You can find a guard, I think, to kind of fill in for Larry. It's harder to replace
Jonathan Cooper too.
Yeah.
So he's a young player. He's pretty good.
It's harder to replace a tackle than it is a guard, I think. So they're gonna move Lael Collins to tackle, I think.
Yeah.
But again, to lose two important guys with offensive line could be a little bit of chink in their armor for them, but they still have the best center in football, still have the best guard in football, and they have one of the best tackles in football.
Exactly.
So they're still pretty stacked on the offensive line.
And they ended up losing also this year as their starting secondary. Both safeties, J.J. Wilcox and Barry Church.
Yeah.
Now, obviously, they feel like Byron Jones can make the transition from cornerback to safety, but Barry Church, he was very effective for them last year.
J.J. Wilcox, they match
each other really well. One of them was in the box, one was playing center field.
Yep, and they kind of fit Rod Marinelli's defensive scheme well, or it's more of a cover two scheme.
Yeah.
So
they were able to line up all over in the safety position. So losing two starters in the secondary will definitely hurt.
That'll be hurtful. And then they also lost their two starting cornerbacks with Brandon Carr and Morris Claiborne.
Yeah.
Now, Brandon Carr got that huge contract for them. Didn't really work out as an elite cornerback for them, but he was still pretty solid. And Morris Claiborne, after kind of struggling early on in his career, as a first-round pick, everyone kind of saw him as a bust. He had a pretty decent year for them last year.
Yeah, I was really shocked that they didn't keep Morris Claiborne, considering he had one of his better years since he's been back in the NFL.
He's still a relatively young player.
Yeah, he's still relatively young. He can continue to improve. And, I think he showed a little bit of promise where I thought Dallas would, they're not deep at cornerbacks.
No.
So I thought they would try to keep him. But like you said, they had some salary cap issues, and they ended up letting him go in free agency. So it'll be interesting to see how that secondary kind of regroups after losing so many pieces.
Well, you know, transitioning from the departures, you know, they didn't really have that much cap space kind of work with here. But what were some of the additions that they were able to make?
Well, obviously, you know, with losing guard Von O'Leary, they felt like they needed to find a guy that could replace him. And they did a pretty good job in getting Jonathan Cooper. He was a first-round pick. He's pretty young, and he's got some talent. I think he can fill in pretty well.
Hasn't really worked out yet. You know, he kind of busted with the Cardinals, and then he didn't really find a role with the Patriots when he got traded there last year. So hopefully he can, you know, with this great offensive line around him, maybe he can find a role on this team and kind of resurrect his career at the Cowboys.
Yeah, they also ended up picking up another offensive lineman, Byron Bell. He's an offensive tackle.
Yeah.
I don't see him starting in this unit, but he'll be a good backup depth guy to have in case anyone gets injured.
Yeah, so I think the plan is to have Collins play that right tackle spot. He'll probably be their swing tackle, I think, in this case.
And then a few other, they only had two other more additions. They ended up getting cornerback Nolan Carroll. Yep. You know, that's a pretty good pickup, you know, especially losing so many guys.
He's solid. He's nothing special or anything but like that. I mean, but he can play pretty solid for them going forward.
And they ended up getting safety Robert Blanton, obviously, with losing both safeties. They felt like they needed to get a guy, and this is a guy who could kind of have the Barry Church-type, like, effect. Yep. He likes to play in the box. He's very physical. Mm-hmm. You know, he's not afraid to make the tackle.
Yeah, which is what they need in Rob Marinelli's defense, where they're going to try and do everything they can to create turnovers because they're not a super talented defense right now. They're going to try and do everything they can to make sure they get as much possessions for their offense as possible. Mm-hmm. So kind of going from the free agency period to the draft, what did they do in the draft to kind of, you know, get you excited for their season?
Well, in the first round, they ended up taking defensive end Taco Charlton, which
what
is
a name.
Just a great name great to name. Have. I mean, if a Mexican food company doesn't pick him up as an endorsement, he can endorse tacos.
That would be very smart for them, right?
Yeah, right. But, I mean, he came out of Michigan. He had 9.5 sacks last year. You know, the only thing is, like, he was never a full-time starter until his last year there. But, I mean, he proved to be pretty effective when he was able to be a full-time starter. I don't think he's got really good athleticism. Yep. There's a few weaknesses. You know, he's not really that powerful where, you know, when he's embracing offensive linemen, he might have trouble getting off the block. Yeah. He's not really that good at playing the run, but he's young, so he can improve.
Yeah. Yeah, he's got a lot of great physical ability, like a lot of raw tools that can work with. Ron Marinelli, again, is a great defensive coordinator. He can maybe get a lot out of them. And he could remind him of Julius Peppers, who, again, kind of another guy who had those rare physical gifts that, you know, when they had him in Chicago, he was the defensive coordinator there.
Yeah.
So it'll be interesting if they can get anything out of them. They obviously need a pass rusher. They haven't really had one again since DeMarcus Ware.
Yeah.
So maybe he can fill that role. He's pretty raw, though, so it might take a while for him to really come into his own as a player. So he's got a lot of talent, though, so we'll see how that works out.
I think he'll get a lot of play time early on just because of the suspension to DeMarcus Lawrence. So he'll get a chance to prove, you know, was he worth his first-round selection.
Yep. And the second and third round, they were really going after that, you know, secondary weaknesses that they had, getting two cornerbacks, one of them Chidobe Awuzie from Colorado.
What a name.
And Jordan Lewis, another Michigan guy.
Yeah. Obviously, you know, they're pretty much overhauling their secondary. Yeah. They lost two of their starting corners, so picking up two cornerbacks and a deep defensive draft is a really good move for them.
It's pretty solid, I think, you know. Both of these guys are not really man-to-man type of players.
Yeah.
I mean, Jordan Lewis is kind of undersized, but he can kind of play that nickel role for them. And again, Rob Marinelli, what type of defense does he like to play? Cover two, a lot of zone coverage. He's not going to have these guys on an island kind of man-to-man, especially in this division where there's so many great wide receivers. You know, I think it could work out for them. And I like Awuzie a lot. He's got a lot of, you know, he's got a lot of talent for a second-round pick. Again, a really deep defensive back class. So you get two guys in the second and third round, that can help them out going into the season.
What I really like about Awuzie is that in college, he can either play cornerback or safety for them. So that'll really help them out.
Yeah, like a lot of versatility for that defense.
Yeah.
Well, transitioning from the draft and free agency, you know, we're going into the training camp now, and the training camp's been going on for a bit. So what are the main storylines for the Dallas Cowboys kind of going into the season?
Yeah, one of the biggest stories, obviously last year they selected Jalen Smith, hoping that he could really help shore up that linebacking group. You know, he was injured, he wasn't able to get to play much. Well, he didn't play at all. It'll be interesting to see. You know, he was considered a top five pick before the injury. So if he can get back on the field, you know, pair him up next to Sean Lee.
Yeah.
I mean, that's a really good duo.
Yeah, I mean, Jalen Smith, going into that draft, he was considered maybe you know, once in a generation type of linebacker prospect who can be a beast in the run game and hit guys really hard in the backfield, but also play back in coverage, as you know, in the modern NFL where you need linebackers to be able to cover all over the field and go sideline to sideline.
Yeah, he's got great speed.
He can do pretty much anything a linebacker can do. He's got great instincts as well. It's really unfortunate that he had that injury, and they're saying that nerve in his knee is pretty much healed at this point. Might take a while for him to get back to full strength still, but he's expected to play this year. Mm. So we'll see how he does. I think he's got a lot of talent still. A year away from football might take a little bit to get the rust off, but
yeah.
I mean, this could be a potential home run for them if he can stay healthy for this season and really get back to getting used to playing football again.
Yeah, it'll be interesting to see what kind of role he has coming out. You know, obviously with preseason coming up, he's going to get a lot of valuable playing time. You're going to see, you know, what are his strengths, what are his weaknesses.
Yep.
You know, kind of coach him through the struggles. Obviously, this will be like his rookie year since he didn't get to play.
And again, Sean Lee's the leader of that linebacker group. So
he'll be able to mentor
him. He'll be able to mentor him a little bit. But going from their linebacking core, you know, they really overhauled their entire secondary.
Yeah.
So I think another thing to look out for is whether they'll be better or worse this year.
Yeah, to be honest, I think they got worse. I mean, I think Morris Claiborne, so he played a lot better than he had in his previous years.
Yep.
I was just really shocked to see that they didn't have him. You know, obviously, Brandon Carr, he didn't really live up to the big contract, but I mean, he still played kind of well.
He's a solid player for
he was a solid player. And, you know, they added Nolan Carroll, and I don't think he's better than either of those two guys.
I don't think so.
I think, you know, what they're really hoping for is for Byron Jones to really take that next big leap and kind of be a really big impact player for them
defense. He's playing safety, though. They still don't really have another cornerback to really play that position. And they're relying on two rookie cornerbacks to kind of step in and play a big role for them. So it's going to be interesting how that works out. I mean, usually youth in the secondary doesn't really work out in today's NFL with the spread out offenses and, you know, just how hard it is to play a defensive back in this league.
Oh my gosh, yeah.
So, I mean, it's going to be hard. It's going to be a tough transition for them, and that could really affect their defense this year, I think.
Yeah, especially considering, I mean, obviously last year they were hoping for the Super Bowl.
Yeah.
They're still trying to make that Super Bowl push. So, I mean, you got to have a really good secondary today's day because everyone is just passing.
Yep.
So, I mean, that was a big weakness for them. Obviously, we said that was an off-season need for them. And they didn't really address it. I mean, they took a few young guys in the draft.
They tried to address it by going with the draft.
Yeah.
But I don't really know that it helps them, you know, right away. I think it might take a while for them to really see the dividends of those draft picks.
Mm-hmm.
But going from the defensive side, the offensive side, you know, they had the two best rookies last year.
Oh, yeah.
Dak Prescott and Ezekiel Elliott, who were number one, number two in Rookie of the Year voting for Offensive Rookie of the Year. So I think another thing to look out for is whether they can kind of repeat their success as rookies.
Yeah, I think Ezekiel Elliott will definitely be able to. When he's running behind that monster offensive line, I think this year he can be even better than last year. I mean, I could see him realistically pushing that 2,000-yard mark.
I can see that.
You just got to keep feeding Zeke. I mean, seriously.
As long as he doesn't get suspended and
does
something stupid off the field, which this is the Dallas Cowboys we're talking about here, so it could happen.
Yeah.
You never know. Anything that does go wrong for Dallas Cowboys does seem to go wrong at times over the past decade or so.
Yeah.
But if he can stay on the field for all 16 games, I agree. I think he's a guy who can get 2,000 yards through easily.
I think it's just crazy how long this investigation has been going. I mean, I feel like they're really trying to make an example of him, which is sad because, I mean, a lot of people look up to him. And, I mean, it's been over a year. It's like, come on.
Yeah, it's interesting to see, but for me, Dak Prescott's the bigger one because he was a lightning in a bottle for them last year. He kind of came out of nowhere as a fourth-round pick.
Yeah.
And for a rookie quarterback, I mean, he was amazing. 23 touchdowns, 4 interceptions.
That's
played
incredible.
Really efficiently. And he played very well inside that system that they run there. And with that offensive line that they have, I don't think there's any reason why he can't repeat that success.
See, I know the only thing I'm kind of worried about is how well he played last year.
Yeah.
It's going to be really hard for him going to second year to replicate it. Especially now that, like, defensive coordinators, they got a lot more game film on him. They kind of expect, you know, they know what they're looking for more. Because last year, I mean, no one expected. Everyone thought it was going to be Tony Romo starting. And this guy kind of came out of nowhere. So he's going to have a lot more attention from defensive coordinators. I think he could still do really well. He's still got Dez Bryant. He's got good chemistry with Cole Beasley.
Yep.
And I think, you know, he could. But, I mean, sometimes you see that sophomore year slump.
Yeah.
So we'll see what happens.
It'll be interesting to see. I mean, I don't think he'll be as good as he was last year.
I think he'll still be good.
Yeah.
Like, it'll just be really hard to, like, replicate.
Yeah, it's hard to replicate 23 touchdowns
to 4
interceptions.
I mean, that's amazing.
Not even, like, Tom Brady couldn't even do that for most of his career. He's doing it now with ease.
As a rookie,
But as a rookie, that's really tough to do. And to kind of repeat that, it could be tough to do, but I still think he'll be pretty good next year.
I think,
year
yeah,
sure.
I definitely think he'll still be good. I just don't know if he'll be that good, but he'll be fine.
Yeah. So overall, I mean, we're still pretty high in the Cowboys, I think, overall. Their defense, a lot of question marks still, but overall, I think they're in a pretty good spot. They might have taken a little bit of a step back this year, but with all the young talent they have on offense, I think it can make up for some of their defensive woes.
I think one thing that's important to know, though, is that even though they don't really have a bunch of great defenders,
yep.
the best thing they can do is just to kill the clock by
yep.
keep handing the ball off. If they control
yep.
the clock, then your defense isn't going to be out there
yep.
a lot. So I think that's why it's okay that they don't have a great defense, because
yep.
they have that much of a good running game that they can control the clock.
And again, Rob Marinelli is one of the best defensive coordinators in football. He's going to maximize the amount of talent that they have.
Yeah, exactly.
So that's our preview for the Dallas Cowboys. Let us know what you think in the comment section below. Thanks, guys, for watching.
Yeah, thank you guys for watching. The next team we'll be doing is the New York Giants, so stay tuned.